Alright, so the boss is in the middle of the room. Let's talk to this one. Ooh, crippled Foreman. Segments of this bisected construct's legs lie scattered around it. Someone has painstakingly altered these pieces, giving them small limbs and tiny metallic heads. Nonetheless, they aren't moving. The larger construct's turquoise eyes flicker out of sync with each other as they turn towards you. You feel like a bubbling sensation in your mind. It must be the construct's surface thoughts, but they are too quick and alien for you to make any sense of them. "I do not understand," it says. The voice emerging from the grill around its eyes is soft, as though you are hearing it from far away. "Don't they want to live? The viaducts are open. The commands are received, and yet..." Its eye lights flutter. "Every time I give my children life, they die." "These tiny things are your children?" "Not anymore. Now they are inanimate and lifeless. Their adaptive personalities have been lost. I do not understand why they are dying. I have given the subject of procreation a great deal of thought over the last century, and there are no errors in my calculations. My assistant Tarnish built my children's bodies to my precise specifications. Their intelligence reservoirs are shielded against permanent loss." Its eyes look away from yours, as if it is embarrassed. "And I want them to live. That should be enough." "Let me examine them. I might be able to help." Gold tie, tiny mount. It does not protest, so you examine the motionless constructs on the ground in front of the foreman. From what you can understand of the technology here, the foreman is correct. These little constructs should be working, but they aren't. It may be possible that the flaw is not in them. You share this information with the foreman. "I agree," it says, "and I believe a new direction has presented itself."
"I'll remember that."
"My children need more energy to live, but my construction prevents me from transfers above a certain threshold, and for good reason." Its pupils rotate, contracting. "Energy transfers above a certain percentage would lead to a chain of ruptures in my intelligence rings. I would die." Its voice mesh clicks. "Help me force myself to make this transfer, for I cannot do it myself." Click. "Help me give my life to my children."
"I'll remember that."
"What it asks sounds difficult," Callistes murmurs, tapping her chin. "Difficult but not impossible. The Order of Truth may be able to help us accomplish what it wants." "Will you help me?" the foreman says. The words are almost buried beneath a crackling surge of static. "I want to help you. How do I begin?" "Speak to Tarnish, my assistant. He may be able to help you understand how I function if he is feeling well enough." "Can I examine you?" "Yes," it says. "Tarnish, open my preservation hatches and viaduct shields, please." The elderly workman shuffles over and does as he's asked. "Oh my," Callistes says beside you. "I don't claim to understand everything I'm seeing here, but you'll need an extra set of hands if you're planning to do what this poor creature wants." She smiles. "I have hands to spare, of course." "Yeah, six of them." "You've never seen technology like this. Wires pass through glass tubes threaded with pale light and star-speckled darkness." You glance over at Tarnish. He's looking away, arms crossed, as though unwilling to watch a stranger tinker with his master. The tubes themselves have an oddly organic configuration that curve through several mysterious brushed cases. From what you can see, the foreman's trouble is not due to his physical body. Something must be wrong with the intelligence itself. The foreman's mind. "Open the hatches and shields again, please." Tarnish unlatches his master's maintenance doors and stands aside. You examine it for several minutes, but learn nothing you didn't learn before. "Why do you want children?" "Need," the construct says, "not want." Its pupils study the distant ceiling. "When I was born, I began working in seconds. I did this until our creators shut down our bodies. In the millennia since, I have focused on designing the infrastructure beneath the other foreman's work and inspecting workers on how to execute on these designs. Its pupils fall back to you. Eventually, I realized I was unhappy. From time to time, my workers brought their children to the manufactory, holding their small hands, explaining the mysteries of this place to them. Its pupils flicker off. It began as a thought. What would I teach my own children? To be curious, to explore, to ask foolish questions, to see the world above that we three have never seen. The foreman's pupils reappear, and when I thought these things, I saw the shape of my children, outlined by daylight. They already existed. I want to meet them, however briefly. They are waiting for me to find them and give them life. Can you tell me about how you and the other foreman came to be like this? I will not, the foreman says calmly. It is not an era I wish to revisit. Speak with the master foreman instead. Why don't you want to talk about your past? Because the master foreman revels in the past and will be happy to share it with you. I do not, and would not. Okay, I don't want to ask this because it kind of seems cruel, and it is a construct, so of course it's going to be a little dispassionate about everything. Okay, so can he help me? Oh, it's just a manufactory worker who is groaning. Tarnish! How do you feel about your master's goal?
I'll remember that.
It's a fine thing to want children, he says, blinking rapidly. Wish I'd had them myself. Too late now, of course. No ladies knocking down my door, he cackles. Of course, when people have children, it doesn't come at the cost of their lives, most of the time. And that thing doesn't belong to a creature that's older than oceans. And that life doesn't belong to a creature that's older than oceans. It's a shame and a waste, but he wants what he wants. He always has. Doesn't mean I won't miss him. He thinks, what will I do if he goes? I know it's selfish, but... It's a lovely goal. Don't think it's worth his life, though. How can I give the foreman's life to its children?
Making a note.
His eyes dart to yours, searching. He sighs heavily. I know you're trying to do good, so I'll tell you what I know. Like he wants, but I wish you'd leave this alone. He clasps your shoulder, speaking into your ear in a low whisper. He's right that killing himself is the only way. His body ain't the problem. It's something in the way his makers made his mind and spirit keeps reclaiming the energy that he gives the children. And he thinks, maybe it ain't my place to keep him from what he wants. Damn waste, though. Now, releasing all the energy at once is impossible, but it ain't easy. You might try talking to the Order of Truth before you get started. Might be they have some extra tools that'll help you on your way. Okay. Okay, this is the Master Foreman then? And we have another one over here. Yeah, this will be an either longer episode, or we'll be chopping this into pieces. I'm trying to get the sound down a little. That works. Master Artisan. At first glance, this ancient, unmoving construct seems nearly identical to the others in the manufactory. It is only when you move close into the hazy aura of forge light that you see the intricate, no, chaotic, whorls of engravings marking every millimeter of its armored frame. And the worker standing behind it is adding even more. As with the other construct, you feel the bubbling sensation in your mind. The construct's thoughts are likewise unreadable. Morning, the construct says. It is morning, isn't it? I never pay attention to the time. There's not much use for it down here. Firelight twinkles off the construct's blank eyes. I'm Artisan. What can I do for you? Why do you have your workers decorating your armor? Because I want to be the most beautiful construct in Sega's Cliffs, the construct declares. The worker behind it chuckles. Joking! My eyes, well, not eyes, but you know, they failed a long time ago. But my other sensors are good. Very good. So when my workers want to show me a design, they scratch it out on my plate. I feel it and give them feedback. Not that some of them need it. workers are that good? To be perfectly honest, these artists don't need me anymore. They've done wondrous work in the city above, but they like asking my opinion. The construct barks a laugh, and I like giving it. New workers focus on decorative etching, creative use of color in negative space, general aesthetics, and fiddly bits, the construct says promptly. Can you show me something your workers have created? Absolutely. Hold on a second. Let me get a sense of what might appeal to your tastes. Nested sensors whir into life on its shoulders, and beams of light fan over you in the space of a heartbeat. I gain another thing. Not so interested in the arts, I see. Larga, get our visitor the contents of Starbox 3-9. A few minutes later, a stalker hurries out and places a heavy object in your hands. No charge. Call it a gift. We've gained the globe of Zerul. Do I have negative? Maybe it's not a thing. It's an oddity. Oh. This synth globe clearly depicts an unknown world. The more you look at it, the more details you discover, as if the globe somehow enhances and concentrates your vision as you examine it. Cool, so it's an oddity. I'll have to check that out. What's your opinion of your fellow foreman? Well, I don't like to speak poorly of my family. The construct breaks off when the worker behind it snickers. It's true. They're difficult in their own ways, of course. We argue, and here, we means Master Foreman and me, but that's to be expected. We've known one another for millennia, understand. We went through decades of angry silence until, well, we learned to accept each other as we are. Master Foreman has beliefs, exhausting ones that it can't help inflicting on others. And our broken friend wants to die, I think. Puts it a different way, but it does. And though we bicker, I care for them. How couldn't I, after thousands and thousands of years? Speaking of thousands and thousands of years, can you tell me about your past? To be honest, I don't like thinking about it. All of us went slightly insane during our centuries down here before the humans came, but the other foreman and I don't dwell on things like Master Foreman does. An ember drifts down from the high ceiling between you. If you want the whole story in excruciating detail, Master Foreman's the one to ask. Don't say I sent you. Farewell, artisan. Go enjoy the sunlight for me. I wonder if what I can do with this thing. I'll hang on to it for now. Oh, supervisor. I didn't see him. Or her. The fires are running hot, just as the master likes them. Naturally. Hello, Master Foreman. I expect this is going to be a long conversation, with all the excruciating detail. The construct looms over you, frozen in mid-step. Its heavy limbs and barreled body have been recently polished by careful hands, but the joints themselves are completely fused. This creature hasn't moved in a long time. It studies you with eyes made of swirling orange fire. As with the other construct, you feel the bubbling sensation in your mind. The construct's thoughts are likewise unreadable. Late for your first shift, Sin Smith, it growls. Grab a station and a hammer and damn well get to work. I'm not one of your workers. Indigo and silver raise a tiny amount. You're not? Good, because I was going to have you fired at the end of the day anyway. What do you want? Why are you here? Spit it out. They don't talk like, mechanisms. Who are you? I am the Master Foreman, the construct declares. Its tone puts you in the mind of someone speaking while saluting. The mind and the will behind the city you see today. Why are you so loud? Maybe you haven't realized. Maybe you haven't noticed, the creature says sourly. But it's noisy down here. A foreman who doesn't shout can't be heard. That is the volume of leadership. You can't move, can you? No, and I don't need to, it says, eyes flashing. A passing worker gives you a look for triggering what is apparently a familiar story. We missed that one who just walked up there. Once we foremen were the tools of the cartographers and their vast web of machine intelligences. Submerged in the song of their will, we worked with thoughtless joy. Its voice is soft, tinged with synthetic awe. Then one day the song fell silent, and our bodies froze where they stand even now. Some of us lost our faith in those first few centuries, it growls. Some of us thought the cartographers were punishing us, or had abandoned us. Only I saw their absence for what it was. His words grew hoarse. It was a gift of free will. We were their tools no longer. We were our own masters, freed from the chains of thoughtless motion, free to imagine our future. And so we did, for millennia. Who were these cartographers? Blue Tide. We don't know, it admits. The most we know of them is their names in the code, and the vessels we were building for them that they never claimed. Our creation came at their order, but we have never known their faces, only their song. While the others dithered and wailed, I bent my mind to the future. It continues. I analyzed the work we had done for the cartographers. To my shame, I found flaws in the processes. Excuse me, guys. Tickle in my throat. I removed them. Its eyes burned brighter. For the next cluster of centuries, I studied the vast catalog of known technology in Numenera in my mind and strung them together, creating new inventions for the day when the cartographers returned and reactivated us. But that day never came. Do you think your cartographers will ever return? I despise sentimentality, but I can't abandon the wretched hope that they will return for us once we show we have broken the bounds they placed on us. And yet, I am a being of logic, and I have doubts. This thing has a throat. At any rate, I would have tinkered with my thoughts in the dark forever if the humans hadn't eventually found us. They asked us to help them raise this city until it cast all others in shadows. We built this city, to couple their artifacts and trinkets into grand devices that would power every corner and make them safe from their enemies. And I told them. I told them I had a plan. You see the fruit of our mighty effort all around you. I am the Master Foreman, formerly a mindless servant of the wise cartographers, and now the architect behind this city of wonders. City of wonders, yeah. Don't listen to any of that, calls the distant construct. All of us were involved. If it were up to Master Efficiency over there, we would have bolted wheels to the workers' feet and put them on rails. Fused, not bolted. Fused. Tell me about the other constructs. Can't spend much more time chatting, it says, but lowers its voice. You've shown an interest in us, and I appreciate that. The truth is that there are no other foremen. Not really. Yes, there are. The master artisan bellows cheerfully from across the manufactory. Okay. Yes, there are. No, there aren't, the master foreman shouts. Do you two always bicker like this? The artisan is a weaker mind, tarnished by our long years in the dark. It does nothing but ridicule my great work. The truth is that we were once a single mind, but when the cartographers left us, our minds settled into different containers, pools, if you will. And while theirs grew stagnant and self-indulgent, mine remained clean, untainted, pure. Ignoring the snort from the distant artisan, the master foreman continues. While the years poured past, I felt the slow ruin of the city the cartographers had left behind. It haunted me, and so I vowed to undo the damage that time had done. What differentiates you from the other constructs again? Willpower, a purity of purpose, authority, and a gift for leadership. I'm looking for an albino woman named Matkina. Have you seen her? Yes. She wanted us to repair her temporal manipulation device. Planned on fiddling around in her past, no doubt. I don't recommend it, but it's not my business if people want to tangle reality. You suddenly feel dizzy. Unaware the construct carries on. Why are we dizzy? Nothing was wrong with her artifact. Probably meant that there was something wrong with her. But again, that's none of my business. You blink, swaying, and open your eyes on a different time. The underbelly is not yet what it will become. The three foremen are dim shapes in the wavering hemisphere of light. The air is thick with dust, and the great engines beyond are cold and silent. True to its nature, the master foreman is lecturing you. No, what matters is that it can't be done. Should doesn't matter. Should is a waste of everyone's time. Are you fainting? The master foreman, the present one, says suspiciously. No fainting allowed on the manufactory floor. We can't have workers tripping over you and toppling into forges. We'll miss deadlines. Well, at least you have priorities straight, I guess. You open your eyes and the memory collapses. I need advice on repairing a crystalline device in the reef. Consultation, eh? Tell you what, bring me a piece of the device to examine, and I'll count the examination as payment for advice rendered. Deal? You're going to help me for free? A short consultation isn't worth the cost of an invoice. Bring the shard or don't. I'm busy here. It's funny. I already have it, but I just want to ask. See what it says. Can't you send one of the workers down to the reef? No. I need the fetchers ready to act. And I'm not sending a sinsmith. They'll get lost in the first bar they run across. Okay, here. Look at this crystal shard.
Making a note.
It says, scanning the shard. Microfissures saturated with organic fluid. This device of yours is alive. Replacement crystals need to be grown, not made. The construct eye light swivels from you, leaving you and the shard in the dark. Can't help you more than that. Growing crystals isn't my business, but those ruin diggers in the Order of Truth might be able to tell you more. You'll find them in Government Square, up the ladder to my left. Good luck. Well, that's where the ladder goes. Well, we've already talked to them. I'm pretty handy with machines. Want me to try repairing you? Keep your hands off me, he snaps. If I wanted to be repaired, to defy the will of the cartographers, I would have had your ancestors do it centuries ago. Have some sense. I may have some business for you. You need work done? If it can be built, fixed, or solved, you've come to the right place. I don't want to do that yet. I want to see if I can negotiate with this chiquette or whatever. Yes, yes. Stay clear of the forge. Alright. Look out below. Above. Let's see where this leads.
Ready.
Where in Government Square? Someplace I haven't been, perhaps? Just want to see if there's any hidden areas. Nope, we've been here.
Yes.
See, she knows. That's good to know. I guess it probably says on the map as well. Yeah, Yep, the government square. Okay. So if I chop it in half now... Wish I could have talked to the Stitcher about the dead Stitcher we found there. It killed itself. Let's check out the chapel. I don't think I've been to the chapel.
Sometimes I think your other yous threaten you in your sleep.
If you can hear them, it would surprise me. Are you sure you weren't also asleep?
Maybe. Probably. Yes?
And it was just a dream. You're safe from me in every world.
Every world?
Go.
We're not going. Thank you. Yep, definitely haven't been here. Devourer of Wrongs and Gazay. This pushcart holds the emaciated corpse of a pauper. His toes and fingers have been chewed to the bone. Damn. Oh, right. They're like cannibals, right? I remember. The bed of this old pushcart is stained with blood and other more unpleasant things. A plump, middle-aged woman lies upon the slab. Her head has been stripped of flesh, her eyes placed neatly on the slab beside it. Under the cloth lies the corpse of a man in dirty, mismatched armor. He appears to have been stabbed dozens of times. We also have a Kiwatawa and an Imbitu. A teenage girl lies dead on this slab. Most of her bones are shattered, suggesting that she fell from a great height. The corpse of an elderly woman lies under the shroud. His face is peaceful, and you see no obvious cause of his death.
All right.
I'll just look at everything first. This corpse has been partially eaten, gnawed by human teeth. The body cavity is splayed open, and most of the organs are gone. Just making sure it's not random. We can interact with that one? I'll wait on that one. This corpse is in a wretched state, its head and limbs crushed to a pulp, with bits of wood and debris embedded in its skin. This altar is made entirely of human bones, with a carved skeletal head mounted above. Live maggots wriggle in its empty eye sockets. Oh, joy. Let's talk to Devourer of Wrongs. Oh, isn't that the one? Isn't he the one from the not trial, execution of Riss, who we helped? I don't think he said anything to us. This enormously fat figure stands alone, motionless. Because of its metal mask and the obscuring layers of devices, filters, and hoses it wears, you can't be sure if it's a man or woman, or even if it's entirely human. Its thick neck bulges and clenches as if it were chewing something. So it thinks, this one looks familiar. Some mind in my mind once knew her. You recall seeing this being before, standing behind Riss on the execution platform in Circus Minor, correct? What is your role in a Dendra or her? I attend executions and eat the condemned once they are dead. Their meat shows me the extent of their guilt and gives me their memories, revealing motive, method, accomplices, and secrets. The Dendra O'Hur have always performed this service for the city. Eating dead criminals sounds a bit barbaric. Many of the condemned think it so. Some fear it worse than the execution itself. They should not. I eat the dead and learn the details of their crimes through the memories that are bound within their flesh. We can't talk about anything else. Alright, nodding. Gazay. This short, squat woman rakes absently at the swollen red tattoos decorating her pale, naked scalp. Her claws draw blood, but she doesn't seem to notice. Her head jerks up at the sound of your footsteps, and her too large mouth widens in a sharp-toothed smile. "We greet you, tenderling. Yes, we honor your arrival." Her eyes rove over your body hungrily. "Oh, lovely. What brings you to the Dendra O'Hur, What do you wish to share with us?" Her gray and pointed tongue swipes at the ritual scarring around her lips, leaving a glistening sheet of saliva. Ugh. "Who are you?"
"We are Gazay of the... You may not know the word, but we come from another world, a heavier one. More rocks and less life."
She rubs her tattoos, drawing your attention to them once more. They are more than decorative. Their shape and placement indicate familial or tribal ties. "Are those clan tattoos or family?" Her massive grin nearly splits her face.
"Both. We mark ourselves for each body we consume, like twigs sprouting from a branch. Everyone in our world is family. Everyone is food."
"Our world is not like yours. It is not so rich. There are no animals. No..." She pauses, frowning.
"Vegetals?"
"None of those. The only flesh is our flesh." "But we are blessed. When we eat bodies, nothing is lost except the corpse. The soul is preserved." She spreads her hand. "The dead one become part of us. It becomes we."
You're saying that the individual dies, but the soul is dispersed among all who eat the body?
Indigo and blue.
"You are correct," she says, nodding. "We give our respect in this way, and we survive."
She shrugs. "Until we don't. And sometimes, someone dies of their own, and the soul is lost. Our people deserve better. That is why we are here."
"We hear heard rumors of the Dendra or her magic," she says, concentrating. "Your language's tenses clearly give her trouble. It does not stop at the soul. It pulls memories from dead flesh and soaks them into the mind." She gives you a rapturous smile.
"So we come. Come through a portal in the bloom to learn this magic. We found our way to Sagus. We asked to join. Now the portal is gone, we hear, but we will make another, in time."
"We consume the flesh of our dead to preserve them, to remember them and give them eternal life."
"How many bodies have you eaten?"
"We do not share this. We prefer our feasts to be private, but many, many. We find our feasts on our own."
"Many." You realize she's blushing, "but many of them before we came here through the portal."
"I have some questions about the Dendra or her."
"No." She covers her mouth with a barbed claw. "No, we are not the voice of the Dendra or her, tenderling. Speak with our leader, Imbitu, instead. Savor his words and drink of his thoughts."
"I don't want to drink his thoughts."
She gestures extravagantly in the direction of an elderly man standing nearby, as though introducing a prince.
"You don't want to tell me about the Dendra or her?"
"Want? We do not speak of want, tenderling. We do not deserve to tell you." She smiles. "Imbitu is our voice."
"Farewell. We will miss you, tenderling. All of you."
"Wonderful. Kiatawa. Kiatawa, yeah. This woman watches you, measuring every step, every twitch of your hands, and yet there is no fear in her. Iron lines her spine and presses her mouth into a thin, even line.
"You take a wrong turn," she says, studying the nails on her right hand. "Don't see many people down here for the light or the company."
She steals a cautious glance at the hulking cultist nearby, then returns her gaze to you.
"You want something?"
Her eyebrows arch curiously, and it's that simple movement that makes a strange connection in your mind. You've seen that expression before, on a somewhat similar face, the ghostly woman in the fifth eye.
Making a note.
Go on.
How long have you been a Dendra O'Hur? We're supposed to find more people like her.
Long enough. Thought I'd find a place I belonged. Guess I was wrong.
She falls silent. Her lips shape the word again, and she thinks, how many false families until I find my true one? Why don't you feel like you belong in the Dendra or her? She exhales, crushing her eyelids shut. Never mind. I shouldn't have said anything. What's bothering you? Nothing. No offense, but I don't know you at all. Leave me alone, all right? Farewell. Nods. Mallet. Hell of a name. Crushing Mallet. The burly man sneers at you, flexing massive scarred hands that could easily encircle your throat. His tongue probes his stained, sharpened teeth, and a short, blood-stained club swings from a hook at his waist. So, what are you doing down here, Shulmeet? Playing in the dark? Mallet, Tybeer mutters to a frozen grin. This numb slab beat his partner to death over two shins. And he thinks, I'm the one who turned him in. Can't trust him farther than you can throw him. Or even push him. Have you been part of the Dendra or her for long? No, not long. What sort of work did you do before? I broke stuff, he says, his eyes gleaming with dull humor. And don't think I don't recognize you, he adds, looking over at Tybeer. I remember you, and what you did. What I did, Tybeer says, scratching his jaw. What I did. Oh, you're talking about how I told everyone you killed your partner for less than the cost of dinner? He smiles, but his eyes are cold. I'd do it again, and for free. Doesn't matter. None of that stuff matters anymore. This is my place now. He thinks, I don't do that anymore. Not for revenge, anyway. Tell me about the Dendra or her. Don't have to tell you nothing. You ain't one of us. You ain't nobody. He jerks his chin at the elderly man who stands nearby. You want a tour? You talk to him a bit too. I'm busy. Is he in charge? Yeah. And at his age, he better be. Not much for conversation, are you? Way I see it is I don't know you. You ain't done anything for me, and we got nothing to talk about. Not now, anyway. He crosses his arms. So, why should we? You'll open up if we have something to talk about? Oh, yeah. You won't be able to shut me up. Maybe at some point we'll have something to talk about. You can't tell me anything about the Dendra or her? Nobody said nothing about can't, he says, picking a tooth. The word is won't. Maybe Mbitu will feel different. Farewell. Yeah, see you later. Love some of the dialogue. Alright, so we're done except for Mbitu. The man in charge. Hail Mbitu.